Now, the new man in the hot seat, I understand, is John Grayson, albeit situated in, currently as the Deputy Secretary, Financial and Commercial. John has recently taken on or been appointed the establishment CEO of the Infrastructure Commission. But as at yesterday, he was responsible for financial operations, commercial operations, and the infrastructure and housing group within Treasury. Originally from Australia, apparently a former fly half for the Wallabies. John has held senior executive roles within the public and private sector spanning over 25 years. Most recently, John has responsibility for driving a major public sector reform program as Director General, Department of the Premier and Cabinet with the Queensland Government. Nau mai hara mai e te rangatira, ki te pai pai kōrero. Kia ora.
Tēnā koutou katoa, and thank you for that introduction, Selwyn. Perhaps they needed me last weekend. But I do appreciate the introduction. It's the first introduction I've had as the establishment CEO, and it reminds me of the exciting challenge that is ahead, but it's also daunting. But it's something I'm really looking forward to working with our chair, Dr. Bollard, and the board, as well as you. So look, I know I don't have a lot of time, so I just wanted to touch the high points in a few areas. Firstly, what might be different in an infrastructure commission world? Secondly, what are the keys to success? How might we go about our task to maximise the probability of success? I want to leave you with a note of caution and then throw a challenge to the incoming CEO of Infrastructure New Zealand. So there are many examples of good infrastructure delivered well in this country, but you told us through the consultation process that there was room for improvement. So what might be different? The overarching answer, I hope, will be that we will see infrastructure as a system. And get that right, and the benefits are intergenerational. What it will mean, I hope, is a focus on outcomes that infrastructure can deliver and not on the projects. And that starts with the problem definition, and then drawing on a suite of options available to solve those problems, and ensuring that those solutions add up to a coherent, coordinated national strategy. Now, in doing that, I hope that we can play a complementary role to the delivery agencies, providing a strategic overlay to guide those agencies' plans. It means looking at all of the levers available. It's not just about helping central government and local government prioritise their direct investment, though I hope it will. There are other levers available. Does government need to be doing all of the heavy lifting through the Consolidated Fund? Might industry reforms and modern regulatory regimes attract third-party capital and deliver better outcomes? The Commission can also play a role, I think, in working methodically, objectively with the sector on industry reforms in a less politically risky environment. So the Commission will develop a centre of expertise to sit alongside the sector experts in government and its agencies to strive for innovation and efficiency in project delivery. It will mean getting involved early at that problem definition stage, and with a bigger toolkit of delivery and procurement models. So we should be asking, is there scope for co-investment with the private sector, for example? Or are there pricing mechanisms which might more efficiently utilise existing assets? Can we facilitate the bundling of projects to deliver better outcomes for local government? The Commission will be a market-facing shopfront for New Zealand infrastructure. It will have a promotional role, and the key product there will be the pipeline, a prototype of which we've released already. It'll also have a market development role, so always on the lookout for potential to remove barriers to the flow of capital and ideas, whether they come from New Zealand or elsewhere. So, keys to success. Firstly, I think engagement is critical. Te Waihanga is an independent body because it belongs to the sector. And a strategy is going to be far more powerful and influential if it has the backing of a cross-section. Users and providers of infrastructure, iwi as partners, investors, contractors, and the community in general. The engagement process we undertook as part of the establishment of the Commission, I think, is a good illustration of how the sector can be engaged and take ownership of the outcomes. I think it's important that we play a complementary role. We will not be taking over the planning roles of delivery agencies. Rather, we need to fill a void that will help those agencies plan and coordinate. We also need to be forward-looking. We will not be revisiting past decisions. Our value will be in setting a path forward. So critical to the success of the Commission will be it earning credibility with all sectors and at the same time being influential on decision makers. And whilst we appreciate that that is a difficult balancing act, it will come from the quality of expertise that we develop and our openness in dealings with all players in the sector. Next, just a note of caution. So we expect legislation to receive royal assent in October this year, and at that point, the New Zealand Infrastructure Commission, Te Waihanga, will come into being. But infrastructure projects have very long lead times and their impacts last generations. So it will take time to have an impact. There are projects in the pipeline that must continue. The country can't stand still for 2 years waiting while we develop a 30-year strategy. In other jurisdictions, it has taken some years for that impact to be seen on decision making, but the I-bodies, as they're known in other jurisdictions, are now proving their worth. They have provided governments with that safe space I mentioned for difficult reforms to be debated. And I think another example is the 2019 Australian budget, which was a big infrastructure spend, and all of the major projects that were committed in that budget came from Infrastructure Australia's priority list. The Minister's announced the board this morning, and that allows us to get a small head start, and we will be going at it hard, and we'll be learning from other jurisdictions. And we may find some quick wins, I hope we do, but please come with us for the long ride. finally, a challenge for Infrastructure New Zealand and Paul Blair, the incoming CEO. Infrastructure New Zealand has long advocated for this commission, a commission in pretty much the form they've advocated. And we've got to acknowledge the passion that Stephen Selwood put into that advocacy. But now that it's being delivered pretty much in that form, what role does Infrastructure New Zealand play in the new environment? It's a bit like the dog that chases the car. Now that it's caught it, what does it do? So I think actually that Infrastructure New Zealand can play an even more valuable role. And some thoughts that I have in that respect are providing input to the development of the long-term strategy, seeding ideas, and providing views on reform thought pieces or deep dives that the Commission may do, ensuring its members' views are brought to the table, and importantly, holding future governments to account for their actions in response to the 30-year strategy. So, Paul, congratulations on your appointment. Andrew and Paul, I look forward to working with you both on these challenges. Thank you very much.